Okay. Good evening. Probably today we have very less viewers, probably because of anatomy of cerebellum is very boring or complicated or whatever may it be.
Okay.
Fine. But don't worry, let's make it as simple as possible. Believe me, by the end of the cerebellum, you'll understand what is cerebellum, what are the lobes of the cerebellum, and what are the functions of the cerebellum very easily. Before I enter into my PowerPoint presentation, let me go on. This is something known as Zygote Body, which is a website which gives the 3D models of different human anatomical body parts. So let us see. So this is the brain. So let me rotate it once. So this is the temporal lobe. This is the frontal lobe. You can see the optic nerves. This is the brainstem from front. This is the spinal cord, which is continuing. So this is the lateral view of brain. Okay. And so what are you seeing in the posterior part? This structure which you are seeing in the posterior part, this is the brainstem. So this structure, which is present beneath the brain, beneath the occipital lobes, and behind the brainstem is the cerebellum. So let me hide some of the structures so that it becomes easy for you. So I am hiding the cerebrum. So what you are able to see is the cerebellum. So this entire structure is known as the cerebellum. So once you see the cerebellum, are you able to see the horizontal striations? A number of horizontal striations. These horizontal striations are very specific for cerebellum. They are not found in the cerebral cortex. Okay, so just try to have an orientation. This is the cerebellum. Okay, I'm just rotating the entire structure, and this structure is the brainstem. Okay, let me highlight the brainstem. So this structure is the brainstem, specifically pons of the brainstem. So cerebellum is present behind the brainstem. This one thing which you'll have to remember from this. Second one, which I have told you before, this cerebellum has horizontal striations. Now let us go back to the PowerPoint. By the end of this presentation, you'll be very easily able to tell what cerebellum is, what are the parts of the cerebellum, what are the functions of each and every specific part of the cerebellum. Cerebellum is a very complicated structure. If you go into depth of the cerebellum, there are many things to learn, but practical aspects of learning may not be there. So I will not go into depth of the cerebellum, anatomy of cerebellum, which are not important for you. I will try to teach only that part of the cerebellum which is important for you. So we have seen in the last picture, last seminar. So we have told you there are three parts of the brainstem. So what are the three parts? So this part is the midbrain. This part is the pons. This is the pontine belly, and this is the pons. And this one is the medulla oblongata. So I've told you there are three parts of the brainstem. One midbrain, two pons, three medulla oblongata. And this continues down. This is the foramen magnum, which is opening in the base of the skull. Through the foramen magnum, the brainstem continues at the spinal cord. Okay, so now you have to understand that the cerebellum is present behind the brainstem. So this is the cerebellum which is present behind the brainstem. Okay, so this cerebellum is present behind the brainstem. So what is the structure present between the brainstem and the cerebellum? That is a fluid-filled cavity, which is known as the fourth ventricle. This is the third ventricle. See, so the fourth ventricle is continuous with the third ventricle through the aqueduct of Sylvius. And the fourth ventricle opens into subarachnoid space through the foramina Meggeni. This one is the foramina Meggeni. So you have seen the real picture. So as the last time, again, we'll draw a schematic diagram. This is actually the same thing which I have told you before. So we have the cerebral hemispheres. Okay. So you have the brain, which is the cerebral hemispheres. And we have the spinal cord. So this is the spinal cord. So the brainstem connects the brain to the spinal cord. Okay. So let me draw the brainstem. So the brainstem is connecting the brain with the spinal cord. Am I clear? Okay. And this brainstem has three portions: midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata. Behind the brainstem, we have the cerebellum. The structure separating the brainstem with the cerebellum is the fourth ventricle. So as I've told you in my last class, the cerebellum is connected to the brainstem by three pillars. Three pillars: the superior cerebellar peduncles, the middle cerebellar peduncles, and the inferior cerebellar peduncle. If you cut these three peduncles, the cerebellum is separated from the brainstem. So the superior cerebellar peduncle connects the midbrain with the cerebellum. The middle cerebellar peduncle connects the pons with the cerebellum. And the inferior cerebellar peduncle connects the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. So this thing which you have to remember. Let's go. So the same structure I've shown you. So three parts of the brainstem: the midbrain, the pons, and the medulla. Behind that, we have the cerebellum. Separating both of them is the fourth ventricle. From this, what is this? This is a butterfly. Okay. So I hope this is a butterfly. This is the body of the butterfly. This is the body of the butterfly. From the butterfly, we have three parts. Can you see this one? This is one. This is two. And this one is three. Am I clear? So imagine, cerebellum is just like an inverted butterfly. Cerebellum has a body in between and two wings. Am I clear? So this body of the cerebellum is known as vermis. These wings are known as the cerebellar hemispheres. Am I clear? So cerebellum is just like a butterfly. It has a body. The body is known as the vermis. This vermis connects, and it has wings which are known as the cerebellar hemispheres. So what is the function of the vermis? It connects both the cerebellar hemispheres. That is the function of the vermis. The vermis connects both the cerebellar hemispheres. And how many components are there in the cerebellar hemisphere? We have one, we have two, and don't forget, we have three. This one is known as the anterior lobe of the cerebellar hemisphere. This one is known as the middle lobe. And this one, don't forget the third one, the antenna along with the head is the third lobe. This one is known as the posterior lobe. Okay, and there are fissures. So there is one fissure which is separating the anterior lobe from the middle lobe. This fissure is known as the primary fissure. And there is a fissure separating the middle lobe from the posterior lobe. This one is known as the posterolateral fissure. I'm waiting for your answers. I've been for 10 minutes. Try to visualize this butterfly again. The cerebellum is exactly like this butterfly. If you understand this butterfly, you can say that nearly 50% of the cerebellum is done. I'm waiting for your answers. I'm waiting for your reply. Have you understood this picture of the butterfly? Have you understood what is the vermis? Reply yes if you have understood what is the vermis. And draw it on your screen. Use your finger, point out the body vermis and say this is vermis. Were you able to identify the vermis? I'm waiting for your answers. There is a delay of 10 minutes between my speaking and you hearing it. So there'll be obviously 10 and 10 seconds delay, but it's okay, I will wait for you. If you have not understood anything in this diagram, I will wait. I will answer it back. Because if you don't understand this, entire thing appears as if it's something, once I complete this webinar, again, you will forget. Right, majority of you were able to identify the vermis. Second, identify the three lobes of the cerebellum. Lobe number one, which is the anterior lobe. Lobe number two, which is the middle lobe. And lobe number three, which is the posterior lobe. Remember, this antenna of the butterfly along with the head forms the posterior lobe. So you have identified the vermis. You have identified the three lobes of the butterfly. And next one, try to identify the fissures. Were you able to identify the fissure? This is the primary fissure, which separates the anterior lobe from the middle lobe. And this is the posterolateral fissure, which separates the middle lobe from the posterior lobe. Fine. So let's come back to the cerebellum. So this is the picture of the cerebellum from behind. As I've told you, there are a number of horizontal striations. These are very specific for the cerebellum. These transverse fissures are present only in the cerebellum. They are present nowhere in the brain. So once you identify these transverse fissures, you are very sure that this is a part of the cerebellum. Okay, fine. You have identified the cerebellum. Next, identify the body of the butterfly. This body is known as the vermis. So this elevation which you are able to see, this is known as the vermis of the cerebellum. So this is the vermis of the cerebellum. Are you all able to hear me? This day, I think no one is ready to answer. At least let me know whether you are able to hear me or not. Fine. So this one is the vermis of the cerebellum. Then I have told you it is divided into three lobes. So what are the lobes? This fissure, which is very prominent, is known as the primary fissure. Am I clear? So this thick fissure, which is very prominent, is known as the primary fissure. The structure which is anterior to it is the anterior lobe. And this large structure, which is the largest lobe, is known as the middle lobe. So where is the posterior lobe? When I see the structure, So the same thing which I have shown, this is the anterior lobe, this is the middle lobe, and this is the primary fissure which divides the anterior lobe from the middle lobe. So where is the third lobe, which I have told you, where is the antenna? This is our antenna and this is our third lobe, antenna along with the head. This structure, the head is a part of the vermis which is known as the flocculus, which is known as the nodule. This is the antenna of the butterfly. This is known as the flocculus. This is known as the flocculonodular lobe. This flocculonodular lobe is the posterior lobe. So, am I clear? You have identified all the three lobes, the anterior lobe, the middle lobe, and the third one is the flocculonodular lobe, which is the posterior lobe. We'll see the same structure in the sagittal cut, in the midline structure. So as I've told you, in the midline structure, this is sagittal cut through the brainstem and the cerebellum. So this structure, which is the primary fissure, which is the thickest one, this primary fissure divides the part which is anterior to, is known as the primary fissure. This largest one, the entire, nearly the remaining entire part of the cerebellum, is known as the middle lobe. This is the middle lobe. And the small structure which I have shown you, this is the flocculonodular node, which is separated from the middle lobe by the posterolateral lobe. So can you tell me what is the size of the lobe? Which one is the smallest one? So the smallest lobe is the flocculonodular lobe. And which is the largest lobe? The largest lobe is the middle lobe. And which is intermediate in size? The anterior lobe is of middle in size, intermediate in size. So again, the vermis and the cerebral hemispheres are divided into a number of components. This is mainly for theoretical part. You probably will not require it, so I will not go into it. Yeah. Now we will come to one important portion. We have told you everything, no? Now I will come to one important thing. When I say cerebellum, you will have to remember three important things. Whether you remember all these things or not, cerebellum has three main functions. One of the main function of the cerebellum is balance. Second most important function of the cerebellum is maintenance of tone and posture. And the third important function of the cerebellum is coordination of fine motor movements. So cerebellum has three functions: balance, tone and posture, and coordination of fine motor movements. Of these three things in evolution, do you think, or can you guess which is the most important one? Even the most primitive organism on this earth will have one function, that is the balance. So when you see evolution, phylogeny, the first function is balance. Second function to develop is your tone and posture. And the third and highly evolved, which evolves latest in the evolution, is coordination of the fine movements. So you can see human beings. Human beings are highly evolved in individuals. So human beings have coordination of fine movements, which is not seen in other organisms, other lower things. If you see a chimpanzee or a monkey or any other thing, they don't have coordination of fine motor movements like we have. This is because we have a highly developed cerebellum. And from evolutionary point of view, cerebellum is divided into three portions. Thus, three portions are called archicerebellum, paleocerebellum, and neocerebellum. So can you guess what are the function of archicerebellum? Archicerebellum is oldest cerebellum. See, oldest cerebellum function is balance. So the function of the archicerebellum is balance. Second one, what is the function of the paleocerebellum? P for posture. So paleocerebellum, archi means oldest one, paleo means old, neo means new. So the oldest function is lying with the archicerebellum, which is balance. The older functions are with the paleocerebellum, which is the posture and tone. The newest functions are with the neocerebellum, which is coordination of fine movements. Now, what is archicerebellum? I've told you there are three lobes. When you want a highly developed function, the size of the lobe should be the highest. When you have a primitive function, the size of that lobe is the lowest. So which is the smallest lobe? The smallest lobe is the floculonodular lobe. Floculonodular lobe. So the floculonodular lobe is also known as archicerebellum, and its main function is balance. What is the lobe of the middle size? The anterior lobe. So the anterior lobe is also known as paleocerebellum, and the function of the paleocerebellum is posture. And what is the largest lobe? Is the middle lobe. So middle lobe is the latest structure, highly developed, and its main function is coordination of the fine motor movements. So let's come back over here, that the smallest lobe is from the picture, the floculonodular lobe. So the function of the floculonodular lobe is balance. Anterior lobe, which is of middle size, anterior lobe. So the function of the anterior lobe is tone and posture. The largest lobe, the highly developed lobe, which is present in the human beings, with this lobe is not present in primitive organisms. And this largest lobe is the middle lobe. This is known as the neocerebellum, and its function is coordination of the fine motor movements. Coordination of fine motor movements. Okay, hope I am clear until now. Let's go. We have seen this division into archicerebellum, paleocerebellum, and neocerebellum. But you also have to remember one more classification. One is the spinocerebellum, which is the vermis, and a region slightly lateral to vermis, which is known as the paravermis. The cerebrocerebellum, which is part of the hemispheres. And this is the floculonodulus, which is the vestibular cerebellum. As I've told you, floculonodulus mainly with the balance. And why is the distinction of the spinocerebellum and cerebrocerebellum? This spinocerebellum is mainly concerned with our trunk, mid part, trunk. So this part, this vermis and the paravermian regions are mainly concerned with the balance of our trunk. Whereas the cerebrocerebellum, this lateral hemispheres, are mainly concerned with the balance, tone, and coordination of our upper limbs and the lower limbs. Again, the vermis and anterior portion and the posterior portion. There is some difference in the anterior vermis and posterior vermis, and we'll see later. Am I clear? So we have seen the function of archicerebellum, paleocerebellum, neocerebellum, and also we have seen the function of vermis versus hemispheres. Vermis is concerned with our trunk. Hemispheres are concerned with our limbs. distinction is important for a physiotherapist? So as I've told you, these are the three parts. So again, this is the paleocerebellum or the flocculonodular node. The function is maintain the balance, control of the eye movements. This is the anterior cerebellum, which is known as the periocerebellum. Its function is regulation of muscle tone. And this is the middle lobe or the neocerebellum, whose main function is planning of voluntary activity and coordination. And as a passing by structure, when you cut the cerebellum, we have the cerebellar cortex, we have the cerebellar white matter, and we have deep gray matter within the cerebellum. These gray matter are divided into nucleus. The largest nucleus is known as the dentate nucleus, which is connected to, because it's the largest one, so it is a part of the neocerebellum or the middle lobe. So the function of the dentate nucleus is coordination of the fine motor movements. This globose and the emboliform nucleus, are you able to see the globose nucleus and the emboliform nucleus? These nuclei are of intermediate size. So both these nuclei are connected to the periocerebellum and they are concerned with tone and posture. And the final one is the smallest nucleus, is the fastigial nucleus. This nucleus is connected to the vestibulocerebellum, and so it is concerned with tone. And so it is concerned with balance. So it is concerned with balance. And one more thing is, you have to remember, this dentate nucleus is connected to the red nucleus. So as I've told you, there are three cerebellar peduncles, superior, middle, and inferior. Superior, middle, and inferior. Superior connects the midbrain and the cerebellum. The middle cerebellar peduncle connects the pons with the cerebellum. And the inferior cerebellar peduncle connects the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. So I think I'm very clear with the functions of the cerebellum. So, and this is my final thing which I want to tell you. So this is my final thing. So if there is involvement of the, we have four cerebellar syndromes. We have the anterior Vermeer syndrome. We have the posterior Vermeer syndrome. We have the hemispheric syndrome. And we have the pancerebellar syndrome. So now, so in all the Vermeer syndromes, which is involved? Trunk is involved. In the hemispheric syndrome, what is involved? Limbs, both the upper limb and the lower limb is involved. In the pancerebellar syndrome, what is involved? Everything is involved, both the trunk and the upper limb and lower limb. So when the trunk is involved, patient will not be able to sit in the chair. He'll be swaying around. So this truncal ataxia is common in alcoholics. So in the alcoholics, the Vermeer is mainly involved. So it causes the anterior Vermeer and the posterior Vermeer syndrome, leading to truncal ataxia. In the Vermeer syndrome, the limbs are not involved much. Whereas in the hemispheric syndrome, truncal ataxia is not predominant, but the patient will have a tremor in the hand. What do you call the kind of tremor in cerebellar syndrome? We call that intentional tremor. That is, when the patient is not working, he will not have tremor. But when he tries to pick up an object, as he becomes closer and closer to object, he will have tremor in the hand, intentional tremor. So this intentional tremor is specific of hemispheric syndrome. And also in the Vermeer syndrome, we have hypotonia. Hypotonia in the trunk. Whereas in hemispheric syndrome, we have hypotonia in the limbs. And in the pancerebellar syndrome, we have truncal ataxia. We have ataxia and hypotonia of the upper limb and lower limb. We have nystagmus. We have the scanning speech, everything. So this is the pancerebellar syndrome. And then comes the examination of the cerebellar functions, which I'm not going to cover now, but I'll be going to cover in my subsequent classes. So let's solve this question. Which of these functions does the cerebellum does not function? Thought, coordination, equilibrium, and balance. I'll wait for 10 seconds for your answer. If no one answers, I'm going to answer it myself. So as I've told you, the function of the cerebellum is balance, equilibrium, and coordination. So thinking aspect, thought is not a function of the cerebellum. So the correct answer here will be thought. Cerebellum helps in coordination, equilibrium, and balance. What differentiates the cortex of cerebellum from the cerebellum? Gray matter, white matter, light, and folds. Can anyone answer? Right, as I've told you, the folds, the cerebellar folds are specific for the cerebellum. They are never seen in the cerebrum. And what attaches the cerebellum to brainstem? I have told you in my last seminar also and this seminar also. These are the cerebellar peduncles. Fine. So this completes our session on the cerebellum. Thanks for attending. And do, I think post lockdown, everyone has gone back to work. So it will be good for me if you can put it on the group. What time will be the most appropriate for you to join the webinar? So thanks for today. Good night. And thank you everyone who have answered, who have participated in it. Dr. Kishan is asking, is there any way we can differentiate anterior Vermeer and the posterior Vermeer? Yes, the anterior Vermeer syndrome involves the trunk and also part of the lower limbs. The upper limbs are never involved. Whereas in the posterior Vermeer syndrome, the trunk is more involved and both the upper limbs and the lower limbs are not involved. So if I can tell you, if only the limbs are involved, the hemispheric syndrome. If the trunk and the lower limbs are involved, that is posterior Vermeer syndrome. If the trunk and the upper limb are involved, if the trunk is involved, that is the posterior Vermeer syndrome. Is there tremor in the neck? Yes. Truncal ataxia is also accompanied with tremor in the neck. Let me see if there were any other things, thoughtful. Gait instability is seen in both the Vermeer syndrome and the hemispheric syndrome. When the Vermeer is involved, patient will sway on to both the sides. But when the hemisphere is involved, the patient will sway down to one side only. If the left hemisphere is involved, patient will fall to left side. If the right hemisphere is involved, patient will right side to right side. But if the Vermeer is involved, it will sway to both the sides. Balance. Why is it called posterior lateral fissure? And Dr. Debashri was asking. Because it's situated in posterior lateral aspect. That is called postrolateral fissure. Yeah. Any other?